Very happy morning, children. Welcome back to social class. So, children, in today's session, we are going to see about chapter 2 in history, the spread of Christianity in medieval Europe. So, last class, we learnt about rise of Christianity. So, in that chapter, we discussed about the birth of Jesus Christ, teachings, and about the Sermon on the Mount, and the last topic was about the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. So, here we are going to continue this chapter. So, the name of the chapter is spread of Christianity. And here you can see the green shaded part in the map. So, this is the spread of Christianity during the Roman Emperor Constantine. Okay? So first, after the death of Jesus Christ, his teachings were spread by two people, St. John and St. Paul. So here, St. Paul played an active role in spreading Christianity in the Roman Empire. So he encouraged the non-Jews to convert as Christians. And Emperor Nero and Diocletian saw Christians as rebels because they refused to worship Roman gods. And many were killed during this incident. And the persecutions of the Christians ended in the 4th century CE. Then, Emperor Constantine became the first Roman ruler to embrace Christianity. So, he followed many steps to spread Christianity. So, first one, he granted Christians the freedom to worship. And next one was, he gave important jobs to Christians. And he declared Sunday a public holiday so that people could attend church. And he also built many churches to spread and embrace Christianity. And the next main topic is about the shift of the capital. So it took place in 330 CE. So Rome was converted into the ancient city of Byzantium. So the new capital was called as the Constantinople. So it is called as a major commercial center. So the other major topics which we are going to discuss in the lesson are the decline of the ancient Roman Empire, the impact of the barbarian invasion, rise of feudalism, the Byzantine Empire, and the emergence of the Turks, and the last topic will be monasteries and their impact. So now let's see the lesson in detail.
So children, now let's read the Get Set activity given in page number 10. So the Duro-Europas church in Syria is one of the earliest known churches in the world, and it dates back to the 3rd century CE. And the scholars believe that it was a house that was converted into a place of worship, and the church is famous for some of the earliest depictions of Jesus Christ. So children, as we learned from lesson 1, Christianity did not fade away with the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. So after Jesus died, his teachings were spread by his followers. Who were the followers? St. John and St. Paul. And it was St. Paul who played an active role in spreading Christianity in the Roman Empire. And it is believed that St. Paul wrote many letters to churches and Christians to help them understand Christianity. And in this process, we saw that the thousands were arrested and tortured and many were killed. And emperors Nero and Diocletian saw the Christians as rebels because they refused to worship Roman gods. So now about Emperor Constantine. So already I have explained you, okay? So just we will have a quick reading now. So the persecution of Christians ended in around 4th century CE when Emperor Constantine became the first Roman ruler to embrace Christianity. And he took several steps to help spread Christianity. So what were the steps, children? First, he granted Christians the freedom to worship, and he gave important jobs to the Christians, and he declared Sunday a public holiday so that people could attend church. And he also built many churches. Now, the shift of capital. So, in 330 CE, Emperor Constantine shifted the capital from Rome to the ancient city of Byzantium. So, this was because he believed that the Roman Empire had become too big to be administered efficiently. So, the new capital was named as Constantinople, which is called the modern-day Istanbul. So, it became a major commercial center, and Constantinople would later become the capital of the Eastern Roman Empire, which would be known as the Byzantine Empire. So in 391 CE, one of the Constantine's successors, Emperor Theodosius, made Christianity the official religion of the Roman Empire. So now, about the medieval Europe. So the medieval Europe witnessed a number of events such as the decline of the ancient Roman Empire, rise of feudalism, rise of church as the most important institution, and the rise of Islam, the Crusades, and so on. So now let's see about the decline of the ancient Roman Empire. Next, we are going to discuss about the decline of the ancient Roman Empire. So around 200 CE, the Roman Empire began to decline, and there were many causes for the decline of the empire, such as the corrupt rulers, frequent outbreak of civil wars, infighting among soldiers, and so on. So however, the chief cause for the decline was the attack by the Germanic tribes such as the Visigoths, Ostrogoths, Vandals, and Franks, and the Romans called them as barbarians. So they plundered the treasures, killed and enslaved many Romans, and destroyed many buildings. And the final blow came in 476 CE when a barbarian chief called Odo Caesar made himself the king of Italy and forced the last emperor of Rome to give up his crown. And many historians consider this to be the end of the Roman Empire. And by around 500 CE, the barbarians had carved out of their own independent kingdoms and settled on. And the largest barbarian kingdom was created by the Franks. So next we are going to see about the impact of the barbarian invasions. So the barbarian invasions left Rome in a city of ruins. So the invasions weakened the authority of the Roman rulers because they failed to challenge the invaders. And trade declined due to violent political conditions. And the most important impact of these invasions was the rise and spread of feudalism, which lasted in various forms across Europe for hundreds of years. So here, the King Charlemagne, the King of France, united much of Europe during the early medieval period. So now we are going to discuss about the feudal society. So as you can see, the king held the highest position. After the king is the nobles, after the nobles is the knights, and the last was the serfs. So what is this feudalism? So after the fall of the Roman Empire in the 5th century, there were very few kings in Europe who could afford to maintain a standing army. So the kings granted portions of their land to the nobles, and in return the nobles promised loyalty and protection to the kings. So the kings became the lords and the nobles became their vassals. So it was in the form of give and take policy, they exchanged, okay? And the nobles gave lands to the knights in return for fighting battles. The nobles thus became lords to the knights. And the peasants formed the land of the knights and the nobles in return for protection against enemy attacks. So the serfs occupied the lowest rung among the peasants. And unlike the peasants, serfs were bonded labor and led miserable lives. And this system of granting land on condition of service is called feudalism. What is feudalism? The condition of granting land on condition of service is called feudalism. So this you have to keep in your mind. So children, next we are going to discuss about the Byzantine Empire. So in about 395 CE, the Roman Empire was split into two, the Western Roman Empire and the Eastern Roman Empire. And the Western Roman Empire declined in the face of repeated barbarian invasions. And the Eastern Roman Empire, known as the Byzantine, survived for another 1,000 years. So its capital was Constantinople. And the Byzantine Empire enjoyed a strategic location which enabled rulers to exploit the trade routes between Asia and Europe. So under the rulers such as Justinian I, and the Byzantine Empire became one of the wealthiest in this world. And Justinian I not only introduced a new system of laws, he also built many churches, including the famous Hagia Sophia. The next topic will be the emergence of the Turks. So the death of Justinian I exposed the Byzantine Empire to attacks from Goths, Huns, Vikings, Arabs and Normans. So by 1453, the Byzantine Empire was nothing more than an empire in decline, surrounded by a few smaller villages. And it was such a weakened state that the empire was attacked by the Ottoman Turks. So they captured Constantinople in 1453 and the Byzantine Empire came to an end. So the Ottomans made the Constantinople their capital. So next about Crusades. The Crusades paved the way for increased trade contacts between Asia and Europe. So as the demand for luxury goods such as silk, spices and carpets increased in Europe, and traders explored the markets of the East. Now, towns such as Venice, Pisa and Genoa became the commercial centers of Europe. Thus, an increased interest in learning, travel and the spread of new ideas paved the way for Renaissance in Europe. So the next topic will be the monasteries and their impact. So Christianity spread in Europe and many monasteries were built, and these became the place of monks. So like men, many women also dedicated their lives to God and they were called as nuns. So they lived in nunneries and they were also called as convents. So the monks and the nuns led simple lives and did not marry and did not hold any worldly possessions, offered prayers to God and they served people. And each day was divided into special times for prayer, study and for work. And some famous Christian monks were St. Francis, St. Benedict and St. Augustine. And they stressed purity, resistance to material temptation, pursuit of goodness and self-sacrifice. And the monasteries played an important role in medieval Europe. So they were centers from which the Christianity spread to other regions. And the monks traveled far and wide to spread the message of Jesus Christ. Gradually, many people accepted Christianity. Next, the monasteries were centers of learning. The monks studied Latin and handed copied books. So they were called as manuscripts. They then decorated these manuscripts with pictures and patterns. Monasteries in the medieval period thus served as a center of religious as well as secular learning. And the monasteries served people. They were guided by the motto, service to society. The monks grew herbs in the monastery's garden and used them to treat people who were sick. And their zeal to serve people by tending the sick and giving food and shelter to tired travelers was widely appreciated. This helped to spread Christianity further. So children, we have come to the end of the session. So I want you all to write your classwork neatly with legible handwriting and learn for your test well. Okay, thank you children. Have a great day.